So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Tanya Smith. I manage our South Africa work under the International Crane Foundation Endangered Wildlife Trust Partnership for African Cranes. So we are a program operating across sub-Saharan Africa, and I oversee our work in South Africa. And I am joined today on this webinar by my colleague and also Drakensberg project coordinator, Dr. Laura Jordan. And yeah, she'll probably, hopefully put on a video a bit later and you guys can see her and we'll run through the questions at the end. So this presentation really is about looking back the 30 odd years where we have really had a concerted effort around conserving South Africa's three crane species. And the focus of this presentation is really around how we've been able to switch the direction of the curve from pretty significant declines for all three crane species to now seeing increasing trends in core parts of all three of our crane species populations. So I really hope you enjoy the presentation. It's mostly photos and just run through essentially the drivers of the declines of cranes in South Africa previously, what has been done over the last 30 years to address those threats and halt those declines, and what do the curves of our crane populations look like today and over the past sort of 10 to 15 years. So yeah, hope you enjoy your time with me and feel free to send those questions flowing. So we're going to kick off obviously by introducing our three crane species. So South Africa's got three cranes of the 15 of the world. So we're pretty proud of the fact that we hold at least more than one crane species. So to kick off, we have our national bird. It is the blue crane. It is a near endemic to South Africa, where 99% of the world's population of blue cranes are located here in South Africa. There's a very small number of blue cranes found in and around Etosha in Namibia, but the vast majority of blue cranes are located here, with probably more than half the world's population of blue cranes found in the Western Cape, small province surrounding Cape Town. The blue cranes are globally listed as vulnerable. We have an estimated population of around 35,000 birds, but I must add that estimate is pretty outdated. And it is likely to be higher than that. But what is noticeable is that blue cranes were well over 100,000 birds in the late or in the 19th century. So quite significant declines now. So our second crane species, probably the most beautiful and most well-known crane species of the world, is the grey crowned crane. Incredibly stunning, unique features like the crown, crest of feathers on its head. And unfortunately, also is famous for being the fastest declining crane species in the world. It was fairly recently uplisted to endangered. And in South Africa, we've got an estimated population size of about 6,500 grey crown cranes. What is great, though, is that we are probably the only country in Africa that has a increasing population of grey crowned cranes. So really something to be proud about. So even though they are endangered, our population is looking pretty good. So finally, our third and largest crane species in South Africa, it is the largest crane on the continent. It is locally listed as critically endangered with about 400 birds in the wild. But globally, it is listed as vulnerable with the stronghold of wattle cranes actually being in the large floodplains of Zambia and Botswana. But preliminary research is suggesting that our wattle crane population is genetically distinct from those floodplain populations. So it makes it even more important for our conservation efforts, both past, present, and future. So looking at our crane distribution for all three crane species in South Africa, you'll see the blue hatch there is the distribution of blue cranes. So our most widely distributed crane species with sort of three distinct populations of blue cranes in the Western Cape, where I was saying around Cape Town, that central part of the country, which is our Karoo area, semi-arid. And then the eastern escarpment or eastern grasslands on the eastern part of our country. The eastern escarpment is home to all three crane species, where you can clearly see a nice overlap there between the orange hatch and the black hattch of grey crowned and wattle cranes. And this area really is home to about 80 to 85% of our grey crowned crane population, and well over 95%, probably actually almost our complete population of wattle cranes located in this eastern escarpment. And obviously, home is where the heart is. So this is just a slide that shows you essentially the habitat along that eastern escarpment grasslands that houses all three of our crane species. This used to be the stronghold for blue cranes historically, with our blue cranes breeding on the ground in the open grasslands, as you see there in the landscape. But in more recent times, our blue crane population has declined quite significantly in the grassland areas, with the stronghold now being in the Western Cape there. The picture on the left that you see there is the grasslands in summer, high rainfall area, usually between November and March. And then the picture on the right there is what the grasslands look like in our winter seasons, where we have quite a lot of frost and low rainfall, so that you can see the grasslands color changes. But what's nice with the photo on the right is that you can see the value of the wetlands, which remain wet and recharge our groundwater and our river systems, even through winter where we have very limited rainfall. So looking more closely at the Karoo, which is home to our largest population of blue cranes in natural habitat. That is really what the Karoo habitat looks like in South Africa, the central Karoo. And we have probably around 13 to 20,000 blue cranes located within this habitat. A semi-arid area, fairly low rainfall that occurs during our summer months. And lastly, just to give you a taste of the stronghold for blue cranes in South Africa, and that really is the home of our wheat and pasture belt in the Western Cape, where the indigenous vegetation called fynbos has been removed and replaced largely with wheat canola to some extent. The picture there on the left with the yellow flowers is the canola fields flowering and pastures for sheep livestock farming. So here, the blue cranes have adapted incredibly well to the Western Cape landscape, with the wheat fields and the pasture fields essentially mimicking artificial man-made grasslands. And the winter rainfall in the Western Cape means that farmers are generally harvesting their wheat at early summer in South Africa, which creates these very short open landscapes, highly suitable for blue crane breeding. And hence blue cranes have done incredibly well to adapt to this landscape over the last sort of 100 years. So in terms of our three crane species, there was some significant concerning declines that raised the alarm for conservationists, particularly in the mid to late 1980s, where the data that conservationists were looking at from long-term monitoring showed 80% declines in blue crane numbers between the 1960s and the 1980s. They also showed more than 30% declines in grey crowned crane numbers to the mid-1990s. And also, scarily, an approximate 45% decline in wattle crane numbers, particularly between the 1970s and the 1990s. Now, our wattle crane population was low to begin with, so a 45% decline in a small population was incredibly significant. And conservationists really banded together to really raise the awareness of the plight of cranes in South Africa. And that's really what kickstarted 30 years of concerted conservation effort in this country. Some of those photos there basically showing newspaper clippings of large-scale poisoning, really trying to raise the profile of poisoning events. But a photo as well in the top right-hand corner, I hope you can see over my picture or my face, is two blue crane chicks caught in a water trough. This used to be quite a big issue, where the cranes would obviously use sheep or livestock water troughs for drinking water as probably the only water in the landscape. And the chicks would fall into these troughs and not be able to get out. causing quite large-scale drownings of chicks. So very simple awareness events or that would take place around this could easily address this kind of threat and prevent the unnecessary loss of blue crane chicks to drownings. So if we look a bit more closely at some of the causes of the declines of crane species in South Africa, probably the first and foremost driver of those declines, particularly in the 1970s, were poisoning events. These were either accidental poisoning events through misuse or inappropriate use of agricultural pesticides, so not using them to label, or also not understanding really the impact of those agricultural pesticides at that time, and what the impact those pesticides would have on avifauna or birds and other species. But also a lot of the poisoning was deliberate, unfortunately. And largely it was as a result of crop damage. So the perception was rightly or wrongly that blue cranes are causing damage to the crops, particularly in the Western Cape. And this resulted in some large scale poisoning events that would take out quite a large number of cranes in single events. And being long-lived species, these kind of mortality events would very quickly drive a population down by several thousands over a very short period of time and have long-term impacts on that population moving forward. Probably the second biggest driver of declines of cranes in South Africa, even to date, is habitat loss. Very much so really centered around the conversion of our grasslands. So when I was showing you those beautiful photos of the eastern escarpment grasslands, that is how it should look like. Large rolling grasslands interspersed with wetland areas and rivers. And those grasslands highly suitable for crane breeding, particularly grey crowned and wattle cranes nesting in wetlands. And then the blue cranes, which needed the grasslands for breeding and raising their chicks. And unfortunately, during that period, we saw significant conversion of grasslands to particularly forestry, agroforestry, so managed artificial plantations. And obviously, you can see in that picture, it completely changes the structure of the vegetation. It completely excludes cranes from that area for continued breeding. And also, these trees have quite a significant impact on our water table and the wetlands that they surround. So they both impact the wetlands and the grasslands. We also had in that same period quite large scale draining of wetlands for agriculture. I never forget a time that I spent with a farmer, and he pulled out a certificate or a letter from our Department of Agriculture in the 1960s that congratulated the farm and the farmer at that time for successfully draining their wetland to plant potatoes. So, you know, we've come a long way now as a country where wetlands are highly protected habitat types, and landowners now are no longer able to drain wetlands like you see in that photo on the right-hand side. And actually there is quite a huge effort to restore and rehabilitate these wetlands, and I'll touch on that a bit later. Probably the third biggest impact or driver of declines for cranes, also historically and currently, is power lines, in particular collisions with overhead power lines. For those of you who watched my first, I think it was actually ICF's very first From the Field webinar a year ago, I spoke quite a lot around our efforts to address power lines and make power lines a lot safer for cranes in this country. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about this, but just to flag this, that at the time that we were witnessing a lot of the declines in cranes as well, we were seeing large-scale expansion of electrification, as you do, you know, as countries develop, and with that came increased interactions between cranes and power lines and collisions with those power lines. We've learned a huge amount as a country, though, in terms of the importance of placing power lines correctly, and also the design of the power lines to make them a lot more bird friendly. Finally, the last driver for crane declines is it really around land management and the impact of those management activities on cranes, as well as other biodiversity. And in particular, from a wattle crane perspective, but for all three crane species, fire is a big land management tool that landowners use in South Africa to manage our grasslands, manage the health of the grasslands. But these fires can have impacts on cranes. The photo on the left there is a wattle crane chick, so a pre-fledgling wattle crane that the farmer needed to burn the wetland, a controlled burn, to be able to get rid of moribund material and also to put in fire breaks. And in the old days, most people were not really aware of the impacts of fire. And these fires would go through these wetland areas at the same time of the year that wattle cranes were breeding. And very often the chick would hunker down at the sign of the threat, and unfortunately very often would be burnt in the fire. So nowadays, a lot of our efforts with landowners, and it will allude on to my very next slide, but relationship building with landowners and engagement and awareness is critical in addressing this threat around ensuring crane nest sites and crane chicks are not killed or destroyed through the time of burning. Another land management impact is, in South Africa, landowners need and use fences a lot to control and livestock grazing, to be able to, for security purposes as well, protect livestock from theft. So with that comes quite significant threat for the chicks. Every time the chicks have to move through a fence in South Africa comes with it some risk. And unfortunately, we do lose pre-fledging chicks to fence entanglements where the birds get their feet or legs or wings caught up in the fence. And these are incredibly unfortunate sights to come across, and also sights that no one likes to see, not the farmers and definitely not us. The other land management impacts is really around water, and I alluded to it earlier in the presentation. In our dry areas of South Africa, often the artificial water points for sheep and cattle are the only water available to cranes in the Karoo and the Western Cape. And in the past, turning off of water troughs that are not being used had impacts on cranes that were breeding in that camp and dependent on that water. So we've come a long way in terms of understanding these nuances of these management and these management actions and what impacts they have on cranes, and very small actions that can be taken to significantly improve the recruitment of chicks into the adult population and help those populations grow. So understanding those threats, how do we go about arresting the declines and actually switching the curve? And this is essentially 30 years in the making. I really can't stress it enough. It's almost the time that I've been alive have conservationists been working to conserve cranes in South Africa almost consistently over that time. And I think that's what's been key. But I think first and foremost, the intervention point for crane conservationists in South Africa was really around farmer engagement to build a sense of custodianship, to build that sense of pride, and that you as an individual landowner or group of landowners are solely responsible for the survival of cranes and the survival of our national bird, essentially blue crane. And that was an intervention largely to address the issue of poisoning and to prevent poisoning. So both accidental and deliberate poisoning events, and also to work with landowners to improve management. So like I said, taking those small actions that are needed that can make a massive difference to the breeding productivity of cranes. And we all know, hopefully we all know, but cranes being a long-lived species, breeding productivity is incredibly important to contribute to the direction of those population trends. Poor breeding productivity over the years will drive declines. Improved breeding productivity will help with increases. That and addressing adult mortality. And those are the two areas as crane biologists that we really try and focus on to reverse or switch those curves. Here, there's a photo there where you see one of the landowners with a crane custodian board. We really try and work with landowners to acknowledge positive behavior and positive on the ground action that landowners undertake that specifically look at the well-being of cranes. So how they adjust burning programs for cranes, how do they minimize disturbance around nest sites, alien plant control around areas, habitat protection, which I'll get to. But these are small tokens of appreciation and gratitude that we can afford a landowner, acknowledging their commitment to crane conservation. And this hopefully leads to the next step I'll talk about is around formal habitat protection. So looking at some of the data we've pulled together for a paper that's currently in press at the moment. So the paper title is at the bottom of that slide there. But essentially what we did as a team is really looked at the interventions that have taken place over the last sort of 20 years. So since roughly 2003 and before to date. And using the data we've collected from long-term aerial surveys taking place in the KwaZulu-Natal province, so the eastern part of our country that you see on the map there, we've had 28 years of aerial surveys where we look at monitoring the population trends of our three crane species located in that area. If you remember earlier, I mentioned that this is the area that accounts for huge portions of our grey crown crane and our wattle crane populations, and a significant portion of our grassland blue cranes. So when we conduct the aerial surveys here, we're able to get a really nice picture of the population trends of those three crane species within their core range in South Africa. So by looking at the aerial survey data, and I'll show you some of that data later in the presentation, we wanted to try and look at the top three conservation interventions that we've undertaken that I spoke about earlier, and how those have contributed to switching the curve, so the halting and reversing those declines. So part of that is really looking at determining a measure of our interactions with landowners. And with that, we looked at the number of and location of crane custodians. So 52 crane custodians have been acknowledged. So we've issued 52 farmers with crane custodian boards and registered them on our custodian database. And these are landowners that we generally have a large amount of interaction with. And these are generally the landowners that hold quite significant numbers of breeding cranes, but also potentially the flocks of cranes that will roost on the property or forage on the farms. These 52 custodians are located in 10 municipalities. And you can see there that the color of the municipality identified there is the density of crane custodians located there. And these correspond really nicely with our core crane breeding areas, particularly from a wattle crane perspective and grey crown crane breeding. But like I mentioned, it acknowledges a practical on-the-ground behavior that promotes crane well-being and really helps build that sense of pride. It helps build trust between ourselves as an conservation organization and the landowners. And it also provides a platform to share experiences where landowners are able to share with us things that are working and not working, and then enables us to share it with other landowners, thus building the network of crane custodians through the landscape. So if we move on to like taking it a step forward from crane custodianship, which is really around a recognition, a tool that we use to build landowner trust and engagement, we move towards formal habitat protection. So we look at the actual habitat that cranes depended on. And for the last sort of 15 years, this has been an incredibly important focus of ours as a team, where we have focused on protecting the habitat that's available for cranes, so the intact remaining habitat, but also looking at how we can support rehabilitation of those wetlands that were previously drained. And so this looks more at formal legal contractual negotiations with landowners, where those habitats are afforded the same legal protection as our state-owned or government-owned and managed nature reserves or private protected areas or national protected areas. And we've also looked at then rehabilitation of key wetlands. So what wetlands used to be used by cranes for breeding, for example, but are no longer used because they are now drained or they have alien plants. So we've identified those wetlands and helped feed into the national planning processes to get those wetlands rehabilitated. And the picture that you see on the left there is actually a wetland that's been rehabilitated for wattle cranes. There was large scale draining of this wetland and a lot of gabions or infrastructure was built. And the focus was also trying to recreate this open water within the wetland area that is so needed by wattle cranes for breeding. And it's an incredible, a lovely example of really successful rehabilitation of wetland that's essentially giving a site back to wattle cranes, future wattle crane breeding pairs in the province. So if we look a bit more at the paper I was referring to, where we take a closer look at the activities and the conservation actions we've undertaken in KwaZulu-Natal province as an example, as a case study, we can see that between 2003 and 2018, there's been a 37% increase in the protected area network within this core crane area of South Africa. As an organization, we've been involved with probably about 80% of that protected area expansion, which is something we're incredibly proud of. But most of those sites support cranes, support crane breeding or crane roosting or crane foraging sites. And in total, if we look beyond just KwaZulu-Natal as an ICF EWT partnership for cranes, we've secured over 100,000 hectares in core crane areas over the past decade. This is supporting tens of pairs of grey-crowned and wattle crane and blue crane breeding pairs, and goes a long way to securing those sites for future. So if we look at addressing our last key threat that's been driving the declines, and that's really looking at reducing power line collision incidences and how we can make power lines safer for cranes and reduce those interactions or mortalities as a result of cranes colliding with power lines. So without going into too much detail, because I spoke about this a lot in my previous webinar, this really has focused around the fitting of bird flight diverters along high-risk power lines, effectively reducing crane collisions by 90% where those collisions have taken place. So we know this mitigation is incredibly effective in reducing crane mortality. And thanks to our partnership with Eskom, we have been able to add a significant number of power line or kilometers of power lines that have been fitted with bird flight diverters. And in particular, fitting of bird flight diverters within 500 meters of known wattle crane nest sites. A lot of that work was proactively done in 2000 and went a long way in contributing to the switching of the curve, particularly for our wattle crane numbers in South Africa. So with understanding those interventions and key focus areas for conservation action over the past 30 years, what do our curves look like for our cranes today and over the last 15 to 18 years? And so if we kick off with looking at our blue crane curves, you'll see there, this is the curve from the paper in press at the moment, where we're looking at trends of blue cranes in KwaZulu-Natal province. And that trend there is really heartening. You can see quite significant increases of blue crane numbers since 2003 through to 2018, with that population trend, even with last year's aerial survey, still continuing to go up. So really exciting for the grasslands, and seeing our blue crane numbers bounce back in our grassland biome on the eastern part of our country. So if we take a look at the other two core areas for blue cranes, starting off with the Western Cape wheat and pasture lands that I showed you earlier in the presentation, the trends are also pretty heartening. Till about, say, roughly 2010 or 2009, 2010 in the Overberg on the right-hand side. And also those increases were very heartening in the Swartland up until about 2006, 2007. So what you're seeing here with these population trends is basically looking at analyzing the coordinated avifaunal road count data. This is long-term data set that has been collected by citizen scientists where they drive set routes through these areas. So the Western Cape and the Karoo and the grasslands, they drive these routes and they record large terrestrial bird species, which includes cranes, thankfully for us. So this is some work that Christy Craig, our PhD student and Leiden Conservation, Leiden Graduate Fellow, has been undertaking for a PhD in partnership with some colleagues at the Fitzpatrick Institute at the University of Cape Town, really trying to look at analyzing that data, that long-term citizen science data set. And this here is a technique where Christy's able to model some of the missing data and account for changes in effort over the years. So this we're pretty confident in terms of showing population trends for the blue cranes. And what is quite concerning is that sort of from about 2010 in the Overberg, we're witnessing quite significant declines in the blue crane numbers, an overall decline to date of about 29%, but around sort of 3% annually since 2010. What we're seeing in the Swartland is almost probably like a carrying capacity or a dynamic equilibrium that's been reached. And I'm looking at the summer data. That's a lot more stable data to look at. But the winter data for the Overberg is just as concerning for us. What is driving these declines? We're not entirely sure. And that really is the basis of Christy's PhD. And we're really hoping to get to the bottom of this so we can really look at focusing our efforts and addressing this decline and hopefully switching this curve back to the one that we were witnessing pre-2010. If we look at the Karoo, which I mentioned earlier was the stronghold for blue cranes and natural habitat, so the Karoo habitat, and also seeing a similar concerning declining trend in the Northern Cape, the northern part of the Karoo, and the Eastern Cape Karoo, where roughly around 2015 for the Eastern Cape Karoo and 2012 for the Northern Cape Karoo, where we are witnessing significant declining trends. We are a bit cautious about this because there has been a drop off in effort with the Citizen Science Project. This is what the model is looking at with even imputing the missing data. So if we look at grey-crowned cranes, moving onto grey-crowned cranes. So if we look at the aerial survey data and the population trends over the last 15 years or so for grey-crowned cranes, a very nice increasing trend, particularly a significant increasing trend up till about 2011, where the numbers were increasing quite significantly at a high rate. It was probably about a 44% increase in that period. But we can see that curve is kind of flattening off since 2011, and it seems like we are reaching some kind of equilibrium or carrying capacity for grey-crowned cranes in their core range. So something to keep an eye on, but at this stage, really positive. And this is a trend for probably around 70% of our country's population of grey-crowned cranes. So finally, if we're looking at the curve for wattle cranes, this is our smallest population. I said about 400 wattle cranes at our last year's count. But so the increasing trends that we're seeing for a small population is really, really heartening. But you have to note, obviously, the confidence interval is quite wide there. And that's because largely the biology of the species in South Africa, where wattle cranes at the time of our aerial survey, which is in winter, so we usually fly in July every year. The population structure is made up of very territorial breeding pairs that are on breeding territory, usually highly dependent on large wetlands, sometimes dams as well. And also these non-breeding, what we call floater flocks. These are groups of non-breeding birds that move around quite a lot in the landscape at that time of the year. And sometimes we miss some of those non-breeding birds during the aerial survey. And that's why there is some fluctuation in the confidence intervals. But generally speaking, we're seeing a really nice increasing trend for our wattle crane population in South Africa as well, with new breeding pairs located every single season for the last sort of 15 years or so. So those are what our curves look like for our three crane species in South Africa. And something to really be proud of as crane conservationists, both past, present, and future, for keeping up this work. And I'd like to just sort of end off the presentation with some serious takeaway messages. Well, not so serious, but obviously really important from a crane perspective. But I think first and foremost is to note that this has taken a little more than 30 years of dedicated conservation efforts to not only halt the decline, but to reverse the decline, facing not just one or two species, but all three species of cranes. We're obviously seeing some concerning declines in the blue cranes in the Western Cape, and that is something for us to respond to and understand. But it shows the value of long-term monitoring and as well as long-term interventions that are needed to change a trajectory for a population. I think what's interesting for us when we analyze the data for this paper is that there's been a minimum investment of about $800,000 over that same period. So essentially a little over two decades, we've invested over $800,000. McCarthy et al. Paper in 2012 basically looked at how much it's cost to downlist species around the world. And that paper came up with a figure of about $840,000 over a minimum of a 10-year period to downlist a species. Now that obviously varies depending on the species and the life history trait of those species, but it's a significant investment both from a time perspective and a money perspective to commit to that. So we really need highlight a need for long-term funding and resources, human resources and other in order to change those trends. I think for us as well, particularly considering cranes are mostly found outside of state-owned protected areas, farmers are key. Both private and communal farmers are absolutely key. They can both be the driver of the declines, but they can also be the actors of the increases. They can be the catalyst or the change agent that is needed to change the trajectory of a species. And without them, the curve may still very well be downward in our country. So a huge focus has been on farmers and really bringing farmers on board in terms of our conservation efforts, both past, present, and in future. And I think in order to have done that, it really was about raising the profile of cranes as flagships for conservation. It's so important to raise their profile. It ensures buy-in at so many levels, both at a government level, both local and regional, at a farmer level, general public and civil society. And I think that's what's really been key. So I would just like to thank everybody really for their time. And I would like to extend a huge thanks to the photographers. I hope you agree. Some of the photos have just been absolutely stunning. It does help that cranes are beautiful. Agents to photograph. But I'd also like to thank colleagues, especially past. I mean, a lot of this work was initiated well before I was even thinking about conservation. And, you know, my present colleagues that work not only in the ICF EWT partnership, but in other organizations as well, that have actually moved on from crane conservation and have taken their passion for cranes into their roles in government or other NGOs. And of course, none of this work would have been possible without funders. That's just a few of the long-term funders that have been with us over the years, contributing to the success story that cranes are in this country. So I really thank you guys for your time, for joining me on this webinar. And I really hope you do join us for next week's webinar, which will be given by our beautiful colleague, Lizzie Condon. Based in the US, where she'll be talking about creating communities that give a whoop about cranes. So a really nice follow on, hopefully, from our presentation today. And I'd just really like to thank you guys all and everyone else out there that has supported the EWT, none of this work that EWT and the ICF, none of this work would have been possible without people like you. And, you know, if you want to get involved and continue to make a difference, you know, please consider making a gift or becoming a member. Both the ICF and the EWT are donor-driven and donor-reliant organizations. And so every little bit helps. So please feel free to do so. So thanks. I'm going to call on my colleague, Laura, to see if there's any questions, and then we'll end off in a few minutes. Hey, Laura.
All right. Well done. Awesome. We've got some really interesting questions. So I'm just going to start off. Kerry Brookman asked, have methods for counting crane populations changed over time, and how reliable are older numbers?
Good question. So for us, for the aerial surveys, we're really lucky I suppose very lucky and grateful that the methodology to count cranes and record the crane numbers have stayed pretty stable and consistent since 1995, actually. So the aerial surveys commenced in 1993. And in 95, I'd say the methodology was really honed and perfected. And it's the same methodology we use today. So it really helps us compare those numbers over time. I think what has changed, though, is technology to be able to record the cranes, and probably our ability to store that information has differed over time. So we've probably gotten better in being able to collect, clean and store data. And that's probably where we've gotten a bit better. And that's also what's driven us to look at particularly only the data from 2003. It's where we felt the data was most robust and most reliable, even though the methodology has been the same since 1995.
That's great, perfect. Another one was, historically, and this was when you were talking about the blue cranes, historically, were these birds hunted for their feathers?
So not necessarily hunted for their feathers, but their feathers are used as cultural significance. So the Zulu culture, the king and his top Zulu warriors are all able to and are only allowed to wear blue crane feathers as a symbol of their status within the Zulu tribe or culture. So they weren't necessarily hunted. Maybe the odd few would have been hunted for those feathers, but largely those feathers are collected from drop feathers. So where the cranes congregate at roost sites, there's a lot of those feathers that fall out naturally. And blue cranes, as well as an interesting aside, are the only crane species, I think the only crane, I might stand to be corrected, but one of the only crane species that does a full molt of their feathers. So you can actually easily access these feathers in the landscape if you know where to find blue cranes.
That's great. And then we have a question saying, thank you, Tanya, for the incredible work in South Africa. What are some of the challenges engaging local farmers in crane conservation actions? Do you experience any pushback against calls for custodianship?
Cool, great question. So obviously every farm is different. I think we also as a country have a lot of history and baggage when it comes to land tenure. And that makes our engagements with farmers, both private commercial farmers as well as communal farmers sensitive. We have to obviously be sensitive to those nuances and those implications of that history in our country. So there is some pushback, particularly from where we actually move up from custodianship to trying to look at formal habitat protection. These are generally legal long-term binding agreements that are anywhere from 30 years into perpetuity. That we try and negotiate with landowners, and there is obviously some fear and concern around the inability, the restrictions that kind of legal binding contract has. So the landowners struggle to feel that they are flexible or are able to respond in the face of change. And in a country where we have a lot of change, both political, socioeconomic, and climate, Those kind of restrictions do create some fear and pushback from the landowners. But generally speaking, at a custodianship level, most landowners are incredibly happy to engage with us. Most farmers are conservationists at heart. I mean, every farmer you speak to, they'll say that. And I definitely agree. And most adore their cranes. So they are open to any management advice or guidance that we provide around improving their crane numbers on their properties.
Great. Another question from, do I understand correctly that the 52 farmer protected lands receive the same protection from the government that governmentally protected areas do? So that was around, I think, when you were talking about the crane custodians, and just understanding what protection that relates to and perhaps stewardship.
Yeah. So the formal habitat protection that I was referring to actually falls under a program that's called the Biodiversity Stewardship Program. And we can declare private and communal land as nature reserves under our national legislation that affords that area of land the same level of protection as a state-owned protected area. So essentially it will prevent the transformation of natural habitat, for example, grasslands or wetlands, to a different land use. So it will prevent grasslands being transformed for agriculture or forestry, thus protecting that habitat in the long term for continued crane use or crane breeding, and obviously other biodiversity. So it also will protect the site, largely protect the site from mining. So any outside mining or any other outside development applications that may be put on the land. So it does afford some level of protection for both the landowner and the cranes themselves.
Great. The next question was, is it possible that the cranes are going elsewhere in the winter for the percentage to drop so much? And I think that relates to when you were talking about the curves for the blue cranes.
Cool. Yeah. So there is definitely seasonal movement for cranes in summer and winter months. So generally in summer in South Africa, our cranes are fairly evenly distributed in the landscape. They branch off and pair off and raise families within the landscape. And then you have these non-breeding flocks that are fairly sedentary from a blue crane and grey crown crane perspective, fairly sedentary in the landscape. So the summer, the data or those trends that I was showing for the summer months, that data is a lot more reliable because generally speaking, the cranes are a lot more evenly distributed. The winter data, the cranes come together and congregate in these large flocks, mixed flocks of breeding and non-breeding birds. And essentially when you're doing a coordinated count, like an aerial survey or a road count, if you miss a few of these large flocks on those counts, it can skew the data, the trend data, quite a lot. So the summer data is actually better data and trends to look at because the birds are a lot more uniformly distributed in the landscape. And if you miss the odd pair or the odd flock during your count, the impact on the data or the trend is a lot lower than on the winter counts. I think for us, particularly from the Western Cape, is that road access is very good. So we are quite concerned that the winter counts are also showing these declining trends as are the summer data. But generally speaking, we are making our inferences or our decisions around the summer trends only.
Great, thanks. Okay, you ready for the next one? How much of the success of this effort is due to cranes being large, photogenic and emblematic birds? I doubt the same could have been accomplished for a small brown songbird.
Yeah. So, I mean, definitely, I'm pretty sure it's, and when you speak to most conservationists, cranes or not, that definitely contributes. Their beauty, their charisma, their visibility for one in the landscape really helps raise that profile and brings them forefront of mind. It makes your little frog species or your other lesser known bird species, much harder for someone to get passionate about because it's, you know, typical human nature, out of sight, out of mind. And that's just, that is just how it goes. So I think for us, it's really around communicating the importance of cranes as flagships and umbrella species for conservation of those lesser known or lesser charismatic species. But I think you can raise profiles of even those other species. I mean, we've got colleagues that are working with frogs and amphibians. Jean Tarrant, who heads up one of our programs at EWT, has just been a recipient of a Whitley Award. And she's shown the value of just raising a profile of a group of species in catalyzing or triggering conservation action. If those who shout the loudest are heard. So I think it's possible for most species, but cranes, it definitely helps that they are large and photogenic.
Okay, great. Another question is, are there any difficulties in establishing migratory routes or use of rehabilitated environments?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. And I think something we always keep on the radar from a crane perspective, particularly in South Africa. Our cranes don't migrate, but some of those population trends are suggesting a carrying capacity potentially being reached in some of the areas. So this is something we keep an open mind about around, particularly for wattle cranes, really looking at the suitability of habitat in their historic range. So where wattle cranes used to occur in fairly substantial numbers, you know, what is the potential for rearing wattle cranes similar to what's been done at ICF for whooping cranes, rearing wattle cranes and potentially releasing those to reestablish populations in areas that were formerly strongholds, but now no longer. So kind of giving them a little nudge into naturally dispersing into those areas, but just helping them along. So that is something we do keep on the radar, and we have planned for that. If we need to, we can initiate that scope of work. At this stage, definitely for wattle cranes. And we have it on the radar potentially for our colleagues in Namibia for blue cranes, potentially though that population of blue cranes has plummeted to a mere 20 birds or so left there. And there's been some preliminary genetic work done on the two populations looking at the suitability of potentially releasing blue cranes into Namibia. That's obviously, I think, a few years off. But it is something I think we would be irresponsible for not having at least discussed and planned for. So it is, and at least we have a wealth of knowledge in ICF to be able to do that effectively.
That's great. Just a couple more questions. What do the flight path diverters look like and how do they work? Are they also effective in diverting raptors? And also there's a question around the owl diverters, which were of interest.
So I'm trying to see if I can actually go back in slides, but I'm not sure I can. Doesn't seem to be working. Oh, there we go. So the bird flight diverters, we've got two kinds of diverters. Essentially a static diverter. So that photo on the left-hand side there, sorry, it's not very clear, is a spiral. So essentially it's called a pig's tail, super descriptive because it does look like a pig's tail, that then gets fitted on the line and you see these kind of swellings on the line, and it makes the line a lot more visible. You then get a dynamic diverter, which is a picture on the right-hand side, and that's usually it clamps onto the line, and then it's got a mobile dynamic device disc that flaps and moves below the line. And the owl device that's been referred to is what you see there in the right-hand picture. It's got a little LED light. So it's kind of a mix between the pig's tails and the dynamic bird diverter, where solar panel charges a little LED light, and those lights flash in low light conditions. So this helps improve the visibility of the lines when cranes are coming into and leaving roost sites in particular. So these devices, they're quite expensive. So we focus these fitting of these devices around known crane roost sites.
Great. And then do you think conservation work you are doing with cranes is having a positive effect on the conservation of other bird species that use similar habitats?
Yeah. So in short, yes, I think that whether or not we've got the data to show that, that's a question. And I would love, we actually really wanted to add that to the paper, was really looking at a return on investment analysis, where not just from a crane's perspective, but looking at the investment in crane conservation and what impact that has had on other key species that share the habitat with. And that will definitely be the next step. We do have quite a lot of long-term citizen science data we can use to look at that. And I think it would be lovely to add to that story for as cranes as flagships or umbrella species for other species in South Africa.
Okay, we're just going to squeeze two more questions in. just before the end.
You got Laura as moderator. She's going to push them.
Are there significant predators to the cranes?
The cranes. So not really. I think in the past it probably would be, but a lot of the carnivores are controlled by landowners in the landscape. But there are predators or animals that would be able to predate on chicks. So chicks that are pre-fledging, we have things like black-backed jackal, caracal, that could take chicks. Even as very small chicks, things like some of our common mongoose, they're pretty substantial, that would be able to take small chick. And then the eggs obviously can be predated on as well by birds of prey. And things like water monitor lizards and otter, Cape Crawler's otter as well.
Okay, last question. Okay, and I didn't know the answer, so that's why I'm asking you. Stanley Crane, was it named for explorer Henry Morton Stanley? Did he find the birds in East Africa during his journey? Are they still found in East Africa? So,
what was that? Was that for Crown Crane?
Stanley Blue.
Blue
the
crane,
old
yeah.
name. We're discussing the old name was Stanley, and he was wondering if it was related to Henry Morton Stanley.
Maybe. It's a very good question. I don't actually know. maybe someone who's online could put it in the chat box if they know the answer to that. But yeah, blue cranes used to be called Stanley Crane, and also the Paradise Crane before they were settled on being named Blue Crane.
Okay, yeah. And then just one last question snuck in. are there papers available on the Farmer Cooperation Program? If so, I'd love to access them. Thanks.
Yes, there are. So I'm happy to share that. If you can please drop me, whoever wrote that question, if they can drop me an email. So tanya@savingcranes.org. I'll be more than happy to share those papers, which really looks at stewardship and custodianship with landowners.
Okay. And cool. That is it. Well done.
Awesome. Thanks, Laura. Awesome. Thanks, everybody. Really appreciate your time. Hopefully see you on next week's webinar. All the best. Have a super day. Okay. Cheers.
Well done.